Now we have a preface to the second edition. That takes us through the modest preface, as we've called it before, to the first, the A edition. Let's see how Kant begins the preface of the second, that logic has already, from the earliest times, proceeded upon the sure path, remember, will be the path of the science, of a science, is evidenced by the fact that since Aristotle, he's speaking of logic as opposed to metaphysics, logic has not required to retrace a single step. And of course, you accept there are certain details and refinements that could, of course, be added. Here, the points, as we've already gone through them once already, should be fairly clear. And the metaphysical reference takes us beyond Baumgarten to Aristotle, key for our own reflections on logic, the Organon. There is, that's the point, little advance. Indeed. Theorists in set logic are undertaking to retrieve medieval logics for what tools they might add to Aristotle's toolbox, as it were. Kant writes, it's remarkable also that to the present day, this logic has not been able to advance a single step and is thus to all appearance a closed and completed body of doctrine. So the principle of identity or of non-contradiction doesn't seem to be changeable. Not let alone subject to change. So the key is disciplinary focus, and so much so that Kant goes on to say, we don't enlarge, but disfigure the sciences if we allow them to trespass upon one another's territory. The sphere of logic is quite precisely delimited. Its sole concern to give an exhaustive exposition and strict proof of the formal rules of all thought, whether it be a priori or empirical, and there's where the problem with Hume will come in. Whatever be its origin or its object, and whatever hindrances, accidental or natural, it may encounter in our minds. Now, Kant goes on to offer a useful clarification of his focus on pure reason as such. He writes, now, if reason is to be a factor in these sciences, something in them must be known a priori, and this knowledge may be related to its object in one or other of two ways, either as merely determining it and its concept, which must be supplied from elsewhere, or as also making it actual. So the a priori is the known in advance of experience. Mathematics, as it exists as a science, physics, as it exists as a science, these two, he says, are the two sciences in which reason yields theoretical knowledge. They have to determine their objects a priori. In this case, here's the focus of this, the former, mathematics, doing so quite purely. The latter, that's physics, having to reckon at least partially with sources of knowledge other than reason. So we still have the same problem. What do we mean when we speak of anything as a science? I invoked Nietzsche, who thinks he's doing that as well. So to answer this, Kant has recourse to the most patently scientific of all sciences as such, the science that has no empirical element whatever, and is thus utterly pure in Kant's own sense. And he writes, he says, we see this in the background here, of course, that's what we're looking at math. In the earliest times to which the history of human reason extends, mathematics among that wonderful people, the Greeks, had already entered upon the sure path of a science. Now, that what's key is what's actual. There's such a thing. This is, of course, an illustration from Euclid's Elements, an already existent science. And so the question is, you can't think it's easy, but really the key here is that it needs to light upon or else to construct. This is what it really does for itself, that royal road. This takes Kant to Thales and his isosceles triangles. Here he writes, a new light flashed upon the mind of the first man, be he Thales or some other, who demonstrated the properties of the isosceles triangle. The true method, so he found, wasn't to inspect what he discerned either in the figure or in the bare concept of it, and from this, as it were, to read off its properties by staring at the diagram, but to bring out what was necessarily implied in the concept, that is the matter of the axiomatic method, that he had himself formed a priori and had put into the figure in the construction by which he presented it to himself. If he's to know anything, with a priori certainty. He must not ascribe to the figure, because of course it's not, it could be an abstract image, nothing but what necessarily follows from what he has himself set into it in accordance with his concepts. So let this be equal to this and that be equal to that, and then you see what follows or what is given. So this, in this particular case, a triangle inscribed. The language is challenging, but the logic is clean and the implication revolutionary. So when we bisect the circle, what we have here is 180 degrees right here on this line. And of course, we're going to be able to find what else fits precisely in this 180 degrees that is equal to the triangle so inscribed. Hard on the heels of this clear and patently apodictic illustration, obvious in the case of geometry, as Plato emphasizes by making knowledge of geometry a precondition for any access to the study of philosophy, is physics as such. And note that when Kant speaks of physiology, that's a term he uses, he means the knowledge or science of physics. That's physical nature. He's not talking about biology. And the more empirical, the better for Kant, who's after all advancing his own Copernican revolution, the more cosmological or astronomically inclined, the better. What matters is the axiomatic as such. This Kant here, in short order, invokes Galileo and Torricelli. When Galileo, he says, calls balls, and this is very much like the axiomatic system of specifying what the axioms or principles are, the weights of which he'd previously determined to roll down an inclined plane, when Torricelli made the air carrier weight, which he had calculated beforehand, to be equal to that of a definite volume of water, that's how he's going to know whether he's made a demonstration or not, or in more recent times, Kant goes on to say, when Stahl changed metal into lime, and lime back into metal by withdrawing something and then restoring it, a light broke upon all students of nature. In class, we briefly expanded a bit on Georg Ernst Stahl and chemistry, as this is relevant for, he's also a Spagyrist, as we see, and a doctor, matters for the history and philosophy of science. But in what is now arguably the most quoted or cited lines from Kant's second preface, very influential in moral philosophy and political theory, practical or ethical philosophy of all kinds, and just as crucial for Nietzsche and for Heidegger, so we might argue, we continue to read, they learned that reason has insight only into that which it produces after a plan of its own, and that it must not allow itself to be kept, as it were, in nature's leading strings, but must itself show the way with principles of judgment based upon fixed laws constraining nature to give answer to questions of reason's own determining. Now, accidental observations, this is, we can see just, we have just a little illustration of the leading strings. That's Peter Paul Rubens, his wife Helene Formo, and their son, Franz. We go on to say, very key point, accidental observations can never be made, the key point, to yield a necessary law, which reason alone is concerned to discover. Now, and this, to answer a key question posed on the discussion board before this week's evening class, is the issue of experimental science, as even Nietzsche, rather radical kind of post-Kantian, declares that he's making an attempt with the truth, for which of course he means in his German, which is also Kant's German, that he's experimenting with truth, the very idea, quite in the sense Kant specifies as we read, reason holding in one hand its principles according to which alone concordant appearances can be admitted as equivalent to laws, and in the other, the experiment which it has devised in conformity with these principles must approach nature in order to be taught by it. Now, as Howard Kegel explicates this point, as Nietzsche likewise does, as Gillian Rose does, albeit more with respect to Hegel, it must not, however, this is Kant, do so in the character of a pupil who listens to everything that the teacher chooses to say, but of an appointed judge who compels the witnesses to answer questions which he has himself formulated. It's a very, very ideal notion of the court. We're not sure courts work this way in quite the same way, but they did then. It's Nietzsche and not Hegel who draws out the full implications of what Kant here emphasizes, as he says that even physics, therefore, owes the beneficent revolution in its point of view entirely to the happy thought that while reason must seek in nature not to fictitiously ascribe to it, whatever, as not being knowable through reason's own resources, has to be learnt, if learnt at all, only from nature. It must adopt as its guide in so seeking that which it has itself put into nature. Very interesting set of claims. Now, Kant's analogy is key and deliberate, as he sees himself as the primary architect for this thread, as it were, as physics as such. So he says, it's thus that the study of nature has entered on the secure path of a science after having for so many centuries been nothing but a process of merely random groping. And we'll see that again when we get to Heidegger. Kant thus claims that he has, via the critique as such, articulated the one and only way, he's very clear about this, of setting metaphysics on the path of a science. Though, he says, it's older than all other sciences and would survive, even if all the rest was swallowed up in the abyss of an all-destroying barbarism, think of the beginning of Alistair MacIntyre's After Virtue, it is not yet had the good fortune to enter upon the secure path of a science. And clearly he thinks of himself as being the one who's doing it. Now, we should note the essential complementarity of experience. And to this extent, Kant offers us, as Heidegger emphasizes, what's properly a phenomenology. Thus, we continue reflecting on metaphysics as our science, as Kant argues that the efforts of metaphysics continually come up short, as he says, for in it, reason is perpetually being brought to a stand, even when the laws into which it's seeking to have, as it professes, an a priori insight are those that are confirmed by our most common experiences. Ever and again, we have to retrace our steps as not leading us in the direction in which we wish or might desire to go. This is the scandal of metaphysics, that it's not a science, that it's not yet a science. And Kant puts this scandal in the form of a question. What he asks then is the reason why in this field the sure road to science has not hitherto been found. And nota bene, we're talking metaphysics. And it's this question that takes him to a self-declared Copernican revolution. Hitherto, he says, it has been assumed that all our knowledge must conform to objects. That would be the conformity, a theory of truth, kind of adequatio, we'll talk about that later, between the intellect and the thing. But he says all attempts to extend our knowledge of objects by establishing something in regard to them a priori by means of concepts have on this assumption ended in failure. We must therefore make trial whether we may not have more success in the tasks of metaphysics if we suppose that objects must conform to our knowledge. Now, the focus on the heavens and the insight into the kind of geometrical thinking required for thinking, as Newton called it, God's sensorium, that is space, permits Kant to continue the analogy with Copernicus, he says, who, failing of satisfactory progress in explaining the movements of the heavenly bodies on the supposition that they all, this was the Ptolemaic assumption, revolved around our spectator, he tried whether he might not have better success if he made the spectator to revolve and the stars to remain at rest. And it's just this Copernican analogy which gives Kant both his insight and its necessity. So a similar experiment can be tried in metaphysics, and just this is Kant's project, as we sought to emphasize, as regards the intuition of objects. So this is in bold. If intuition must conform to the constitution of the objects, he says, I don't see how we could know anything of the latter a priori, but if the object, this would be the different point, as object of the senses, must conform to the constitution of our faculty of intuition, I have no difficulty in conceiving such a possibility. So experience as such, in order to be experience, as Kant says, as he goes on, is itself a species of knowledge, which involves understanding, and understanding has rules, which I must presuppose as being in me prior to objects being given to me, and therefore as being a priori. defined expression, this is in bold, in a priori concepts to which all objects of experience necessarily conform and with which they must agree. And again, quite explicitly, he says, as regards objects, which are thought solely through reason and indeed as necessary, but which can never, at least not in the manner in which reason thinks them, be given in experience, the attempts at thinking them, for they must admit of being thought, will furnish an excellent test of what we're adopting as our new method of thought. Namely, this is the key, that we can know, here it is in bold, a priori of things, only what we ourselves put into them. And that's the very radical claim that Kant makes. The a priori emphasis brings us to what may alternately be known as the noumenal limit, or what Strawson also names the bounds of sense. For we are brought to the conclusion that we can never transcend the limits of possible experience, though that is precisely what this science is concerned above all else to achieve. This situation yields, he goes on to say, however, just the very experiment by which indirectly we're enabled to prove the truth of this first estimate of our a priori knowledge of reason, namely, that such knowledge has to do only with appearances and must leave the thing in itself as indeed real per se, but as not known by us. Okay, very important. And to this extent, if metaphysically minded, we still are in search of, as we would be, the unconditioned, he says, he goes on to say, here's another slide. For what necessarily forces us to transcend the limits of experience or sense and of appearances, things that can be perceived, is the unconditioned, which reason by necessity and by right demands in things in themselves as required to complete the series of conditions. There's got to be something behind everything that is manifest. Now, we're going to encounter this again as we read about the conditioned and unconditioned later on, but here the demand yields the Copernican insight, and it's this that affords Kant a solution to Hume's challenge, quite on the level of necessity, he says, if then on the supposition that our empirical knowledge conforms to objects as things in themselves, we find that the unconditioned cannot be thought without contradiction, and that when, on the other hand, we suppose that our representation of things as they're given to us does not conform to these things as they are in themselves, but that these objects, as appearances, conform to our mode of representation, the contradiction vanishes. So we have something fairly important, because if therefore we thus find that the unconditioned isn't to be met with in things so far as we know them, that is, so far as they're given to us, but only, this is the solution, so far as we do not know them, that is, so far as they are things in themselves, we're justified in concluding what we first assumed for the purposes of experiment is now definitely confirmed. This gives us, we noted this before in class, this German footnote, die Sache an sich selbst, the thing, the substance, the matter in itself, itself. And it's the reason, this reason, that both Gerd Buchdahl, Metaphysics and Philosophy of Science, Exact Science, and Michael Friedman, who has Kant and the Exact Sciences, but also more recently, the editor of Kant and the Sciences, Eric Watkins, and of course others, will and are interested in exploring Kant for the sake of a proper philosophy of science that might, as it were, be worthy of the name of a science, a scientific philosophy of science. I make a similar claim for what Nietzsche is trying to do for the sake of a philosophy of science. Now, Kant himself makes the same claims for his own project. He writes, this attempt to alter the procedure, which has hitherto prevailed in metaphysics by completely revolutionizing it in accord with the example set by the geometers and physicists, forms indeed the main purpose of this critique of pure speculative reason. That's in bold. It is a treatise on the method, not a system of the science itself. Kant continues here in terms of what necessarily follows from this same methodological project. He says, at the same time, it marks out the whole plan of the science, both as regards its limits and as regards its entire internal structure. For pure speculative reason has this peculiarity, that it can measure its powers according to the different ways in which it chooses the objects of its thinking, and can also give an exhaustive enumeration of the various ways in which it propounds its problems, and so is able, nay bound, to trace the complete outline of a system of metaphysics. Now, it's just this architectonic coherence that allows Kant to claim success for his own project. He says, consequently, you can see him saying this here, metaphysics has also this singular advantage, such as falls to the lot of no other science which deals with objects, for logic, very important point, is concerned only with the form of thought in general. That's why we sometimes speak of formal logic, that, and sometimes informal, but that means not very conclusive, that should it through this critique be set upon the secure path of our science, it's capable of acquiring exhaustive knowledge of its entire field. The previous reference to Strawson's bounds of sense, and we'll be reading this later, is also illustrated here in these prefatory remarks, as he goes on to say, on a cursory view of the present work, it can seem that its results are merely negative, warning us that we must never venture with speculative reason beyond the limits of experience. Such is in fact its primary use. He admits that, he doesn't say but no, he says but yes. So such teaching at once acquires a positive value, he says, when we recognize that the principles with which speculative reason ventures out beyond its proper limits do not in effect extend the employment of reason, but as we find on closer scrutiny, inevitably narrow it. Kant summarizes, and that's, of course, our key and important point, the project that then follows. He says, these are the negative limits, we're going to go beyond that, that space and time, that's in bold, are only forms of sensible intuition. That kind of could be a definition, and you could take a note of that. And so only conditions of the existence of things as appearances, that moreover we've no concepts of understanding and consequently no elements for the knowledge of things, save insofar as intuition can be given corresponding to these concepts, and that we can therefore have no knowledge of any object as thing in itself, but only insofar as it is an object of sensible intuition, there at the bottom of that quote, that is, an appearance. All this is proved in the analytical part of the critique. In other words, it does indeed follow that all possible, and this is the continuation of that quote, speculative knowledge of reason is limited to mere objects of experience. So that's the furthest it can go. The comfort, and I've added the German word Trost here, is that our further contention must also be duly borne in mind, namely that, though we can't know these objects as things in themselves, we must yet be in position at least to think them as things in themselves, noumena. Otherwise, we should be landed in the absurd conclusion that there can be appearance without any, oh no, I'm coughing, it's something you would want to cough about. There can be appearance without anything that appears. You wouldn't be able to have that because there's got to be something hypokaimen on underlying appearance. Kant's caution, as we see even more strongly in his own difference from Baumgarten's appeal to the inclined reader and the seductive claim that many might find themselves in the collectivity of the same, for Kant, the work is necessarily esoteric or aquamatic, and we read as a result, dogmatism is the dogmatic procedure of pure reason without previous criticism of its own powers. And so he's telling you, he's giving you that. Kant, to this extent, tells the inclined reader, if you still retain an inclination, if you're still reading his critique for the second time, which is what you'd have to be doing reading the B edition, right? Meaning you'd be reading the second version of the same first book published in 1787, that his reason for his tone may be personal. It may stem, as he says, from his own sense of time and its limitations. He says, in the course of these labors, I have advanced somewhat far in years. This month I reach my 64th year, and I must be careful with my time. Now, in his teaching guide, as we could regard the prolegomena, Kant begins by delimiting the readership of the text, at least for teachers, and we remember that he identified himself among these. Remember, these prolegomena are not for the use of apprentices, but of, we quoted this already, so if it seems familiar, there's a reason to help them organize the presentation of an already existing science, but to work it out. So here you're being invited to do this yourself and to discover the science itself, as it were, for the first time. Once again, we recall the question we began with when we cited this for the first time as part of Kant's project, as we cited that then, to pose the question above the question of what's the most important thing, or above all else, whether such a thing as metaphysics is even possible at all. So, contra Baumgarten, metaphysics is not a question of logic as such, nor indeed contra Locke and others and their spiritual heirs, that could be those seeking, as it were, the neuroscience of pure reason, rather than a critique of the same. And Kant's going to stay with the value of critique. To that extent, Kant is not inquiring into the conditions of the possibility of material implication or entailment, if A, then B, or A implies B, or once again, A, if A, then B. Now, we're going to come to a kind of conclusion here, just to recall and to anticipate that in the prolegomena, Kant foregrounds David Hume, who indisputably proved that it's wholly impossible for reason to think such a connection a priori and from concepts, because this connection contains necessity, and that's the problem. It's simply not to be seen. How it could be that because something is, something else necessarily must also be, and therefore how the concepts of such a connection could be introduced a priori. Next week, we'll take a step back, as we shall see with Heidegger. That was a step back to the last slide, but here we go. Before proceeding later to in the month after Heidegger to the introduction to the critique, and we're never going to get quite free of the prolegomena, a quick review of the prolegomena. Thank you for your attention.